Hey everyone, this is Victor from Growth Evolution Development Ground, GEDground.com. In today's video, I want to talk to you about failure and success. I'm making this video for those of you that are struggling with failure or see that there may be some failure ahead and what can you do when it comes towards you. And the thing is that I think that failure is probably the biggest problem on the way to success, right? It's not so much about beginning something new, taking those first steps, getting into the unknown, you know. It's about not being able to overcome those difficult times. And the problem is not because we don't know how to handle our difficulties, but I think the problem is because we fail to anticipate them. They hit us then when we expected the least. And the thing is that whenever we look ahead into something new, we judge it from the perspective of a rookie. At the moment, it seems like, it's not going to be difficult. We can, you know, overcome whatever we want to. It shouldn't be difficult because we're all hyped up and we're ready to go there. But when we haven't yet at that moment spent a lot of time, you know, effort, money into this. We haven't put our soul and our heart into it. But when we do, we have actually spent a long time doing something, you know, spent money and all that stuff. Failure and adversity, they gain a whole new meaning, and they can really break us if they, you know, come without us expecting it. And the problem is, or the question is then, will you be able to overcome these things or not? And that's what actually separates successful people from those that are not so successful. The fact that they can handle failure, they keep pushing through it no matter what. Failing doesn't mean that you have to stop and never try again and that, you know, you did something bad and it's not for you. No, it's about learning, and there's nothing, you know, that can be done in this world well and, you know, get you far without you failing at it at some point. It's just part of the process. And you have to understand that no successful person was born successful. They all had to learn, you know, the things that they do well now. They all had to get there somehow. And failure and adversity were those things that they gradually mastered, and that they learned to not care about these things so much as, you know, as much as some people do. And to kind of get it a little more clear, I have a few short stories that I want to share with you of these famous people that had a lot of adversity in their life and failure so big that we wish, you know, we just hope that it would never happen to us because it's so big. And I hope these stories will kind of show you that failure is as much to success as breathing is to life. It's just normal. It's part of the process. And instead of being afraid of failing and, you know, being scared of going and, you know, doing it anyway, you have to learn to expect it, to learn from it, and embrace it when it comes, because it's part of the process, it's part of the game, and it's part of life. And so the first story that I want to share with you, these are just, I think, four short, basically, stories that I found that I wanted to share with you. And the first story concerns Thomas Edison, right? The person that we all know as the one who invented the light bulb. Well, he did not really technically invent it, but he perfected it to the point that, you know, that we can use it today, that everybody can use it in their house. And when he was young, his teachers basically said to him that, you know, he won't be able to learn anything. And he was schooled at home by his mother because of that. And in the few first of his jobs, he was fired because, from, you know, the words of his bosses, he was non-productive. And we all know him as the inventor of the light bulb, but what most of us don't know is that he was actually a serial entrepreneur of his times. And any entrepreneur is gonna fail a lot, and especially, you know, in those times when there was no data to back up all the information, to actually have, there was no really like scientific approach to making business, and I mean like no data to base your future thoughts and inventions on. And he started many things. He invented, you know, many different things. And there was a company that he started. It was called the Edison Portland Cement Co. And the idea was that they'd use cement to create all kind of, you know, to build things and create all kind of structures using cement. And that company never became big because, you know, cement was too expensive at the time. And, you know, that was pretty much a failure. Of course, the company did earn some kind of revenue. They did use the company once in a while, but it never became anything big. Then also Edison wanted for the Congress to invent this machine, this system that would, you know, automatically count the votes. And he thought this is going to be a breakthrough, that everybody's going to need it. And he thought that, you know, that's the thing. Well, there was a reason why the counts were calculated, you know, slowly, manually, one by one. And the Congress basically rejected his system, the one that he worked on for so long. And he invented so many different things. Actually, you know, throughout his lifetime, he had over 1,000 patents, you know, acquired to protect his ideas and inventions, because he never stopped. He constantly kept improving things and inventing things. And concerning the light bulb, he said that to get to the light bulb that actually worked, he had to go through over 10,000 different prototypes. And when people asked him that, what does it feel like to fail 10,000 times? And to that he replied, "I have not failed 10,000 times. I have successfully found 10,000 ways that will not work." And this is a beautiful quote, and I think this is the exact mindset that we all should have, that failure is not something that's supposed to break us, but instead rather something that should teach us something. And by looking at these you know, things that did not work, we should just be able to make better decisions in the future. And that's exactly what Edison did, and we all know him today. Next example is Ludwig van Beethoven, and we all know him as the classical composer. And he's at early stages in his life. His teachers also said to him, his music teacher said to him that as a composer, he's hopeless. And later in his life, he was, you know, criticized really heavily for the music that he created. Yet we all know him today. And he was the one, even though he was really heavily criticized, he was the one to actually help, you know, the music, the classical era, make that shift into the romantic era, the music, you know, of the future at the time. And again, we all know him today. And the criticism did not stop him. And the thing is that he wrote symphonies, right? And this is something that most of us can't even imagine. I have no really musical background, and I think this writing a symphony is just like, it's just insane, you know, how much brilliance you have to have. And not only it was difficult, like extremely difficult, and he did it, but it made it, what made it a lot more worse for him was the fact that he was going deaf. By the end of his 20s, he started to lose his hearing. And there's a story of how he, with a friend of his, another composer called Ferdinand Ries, they were, you know, just walking outside, and they saw a shepherd playing the playing a pipe, and they both could see how he was playing the pipe, but only Ries could actually hear its beauty. And that's when Beethoven for the first time realized that he's going deaf, and it's said that incident has changed his life forever. And so he started going deaf in his 20s, and he was going slowly but surely deaf, and but he did not give up. He knew that music is that only thing that really turns him on, that's something that he can do so well, and that's something that he wants to do for the rest of his life. And think about it, that's your life goal, your passion, your desire, you know, to wake up every day, and that's being taken away from you because you're going deaf. It's a really serious life situation, but like I said, it didn't stop him. He continued to make music anyway. He, in the beginning, he used lower notes because those are the ones that he could hear better than the, you know, than the higher notes. And so at first his music became lower. And the thing is that he did go completely deaf, but that did not stop him. He still composed music, and he could not rely on any sound at the moment then anymore. He could only rely on the sounds that were inside of his mind. And one of the most known, you know, symphonies of his that everybody has heard of is the Symphony Number 9. And that was written by him when he was completely deaf. If you don't know about it, just write Symphony Number 9 in YouTube and you will hear. It's a really beautiful art piece, and this music is really incredible, and it's so hard to imagine that a person was deaf when he wrote this. And this is another story of how somebody who was so passionate about this thing that, you know, even despite going deaf, he continued working on it. And think about it, this is not like a small failure that you're facing. This is something so big. This is a life, you know, situation that you cannot change. This is, you know, it's your physical body, it's your health, it's something that you cannot return. But yet he pushed through. The next story is about Walt Disney. And Walt Disney, we all know him, we've enjoyed so many cartoons in our childhood, and still do up to this day. And he's somebody who's had a lot of impact, at least on my life, I know that. And he was also an entrepreneur, and like I said, anybody who's taken an entrepreneurial path in their life, they're, you know, failure and adversity, they're gonna be definitely something that you're gonna have to face from time to time. And Walt Disney, at the age of 22, he was fired from the Missouri newspaper because he was not creative enough. And one of his first companies, Lafogram Studios, never succeeded and eventually became bankrupt. And he moved to Los Angeles with a suitcase full of clothing and some drawing materials, and with $40 in his pocket. And he moved to Los Angeles, and he, at the moment, he knew that there's so many other, you know, people who would draw so much better, and he doubted himself so much that he wanted to originally become a Hollywood actor, but also that never happened. And in the 1920s, he finally had his own studio with other people that he was, you know, he was creating basically cartoons, and he was asked by to make something new by this person. He was asked to create something new, and he decided to do it, and he came up with Oswald the Rabbit. Maybe some of you know, but this had very high potential. He knew about it. And when in 1928 Disney asked for a larger fee for the production of the series of this Oswald the Rabbit, he got a very unexpected answer. The Charles Mintz, who was the producer at the time, you know, who asked Disney to do this, he actually said that he's gonna reduce the fees. And Disney didn't want to agree to this. He refused to agree this, and he did. He said, no, I don't want, you know, this can't happen. And what happened was Charles Mintz, that producer, he came to the team members of Disney and asked them to work for him directly instead of working for Disney. And what happened was most of the members, they left, and they went working with for this other producer. And because that Charles Mintz, he also had the intellectual property rights for Oswald the Rabbit, because he was the one to originally ask this to be created, he also took the idea for himself. And, you know, Disney was left with no idea, and most of his team, you know, gone. I think there was like only one person, his, you know, dear friend, left with him. Just think about the damage that was done to him at the moment. I can't even imagine how bad that must have felt. You know, here you had so much potential and a team, and you could do, you know, something great, and then, you know, next moment, you know, you realize that you're left with nothing. And none of this stopped him. We still know him. He's this, you know, he's impacted so much Hollywood, and we all know him, and we all watch his cartoons. There's the Disneyland, and that none of this stopped him, and he continued to do great things anyway. And the last example is the probably the most famous, because he lived the closest like to the present moment, which is the example of Steve Jobs, the inventor of the iPad, iPhone, the Mac, and the iPod. And he was the person that he created these devices, and he set the new standard for the world, you know, of what a smart device should look like and what it should do. And the thing is that Jobs was born in San Francisco and was actually adopted at birth. And he co-founded Apple in his parents' garage in 1976, co-founded, and when he was only 21 years old. At the age of 23, he was already a millionaire. And this all happened after he actually dropped out of the Reed College. And in 1983, the company was already in part of the Fortune 500. Just think about it. How great is that? And the same year, Steve Jobs, he recruited to his company John Sculley, who was the head of Pepsi Cola then, and to be Apple's new chief executive in Apple company. And there's even a famous quote of how Steve Jobs approached Sculley, and he said to him when hiring that, "Do you want to spend the rest of your life selling sugared water, or do you want a chance, to change the world?" Really, kind of like a strong, you know, quote. And it's true that there are many stories of how Steve Jobs was actually a very difficult person to work with, a very harsh person. But I guess that's what, you know, that's what kind of character you needed to make something as great as Apple. And there were, you know, they were working together with Sculley. There were things going on in the company. And at a moment, things got very difficult. And they had their differences in opinion within, you know, how things should be done in the company. And they were coming from, you know, there were coming complaints from other workers in the company about Steve Jobs. And there was, as a result, the Macintosh group was taken away from Steve Jobs' responsibilities. And that basically broke him, because that left him powerless in the company, because that was, you know, the thing that he was really passionate about. And he wasn't really fired, but that part was taken away from him. But regardless of all of this, he resigned sooner or later. And in 1985, he actually had a midlife crisis, and there were a lot of things going on in his head, and he, you know, he really was feeling very down, didn't know what to do. But luckily, it actually motivated him to he co-founded a new company with his friend, with his old colleague, and it was a computer company called Next. And Next did pretty much the exact same thing what Apple was supposed to do. It created a super, you know, magnificent computer for that time. And from here, you can kind of understand that it's not so much about the company, but about the person, his mindset. Because, you know, he created one thing here in Apple, and he was, you know, he left it, and he created another great thing on the side, you know, similar to Apple. And it's about the mindset, about him not being able to, you know, give up, just, you know, repeating the process, and to, you know, he kept pushing through. And the thing is that in 1996, the Apple company, it wasn't doing actually so well, but what it did, it acquired Steve Jobs' company Next. And ironically, Steve Jobs was back in the company that he originally had helped to start. And a year after that, he was already the CEO of the company, Apple. And after that came the iPhone, the iPad. You all know the story, I'm sure. And this is another very, very, you know, good story of somebody who had gone first really high up. He had so much success, and then, you know, he fell down to the rock bottom and he was just broken. And in spite of all these difficult moments and these troubles, he managed to put himself back on the feet, and he was rewarded later for it. And he managed to, you know, get back into the company. And great things find great people, I think. And that was the exact case with Steve Jobs. And I hope that these short but motivational stories really show you that there is no success without failure. It's part of life. It's like a golden rule that in order to reach the top of the mountain, you have to struggle first. You have to go through those difficulties, because success comes with a lot of, you know, time spent learning. And you can't learn if everything goes well. I mean, obviously you can, but you've all probably noticed how when something great happens and, you know, somebody says good things about you, you're like, you learn things, but it goes so much harder into your head when the difficult times come, when the failure, because those are the memory, you know, that stick to you. I'm sorry, I got a phone call right at the moment. But anyway, I was wrapping up, and I just wanted to once again say that you have to understand that there is no success without failure. And if you're in this moment when you've been going towards something for quite a bit, and you've been, you know, struggling with it, and you're thinking of giving up, just don't. You know, at best, take some time. You know, calm down. Just, you know, have a little time off and regroup, you know, recoup with your energy, with your thoughts, and get back at it with more motivation, with the stronger desire to keep going and to make it happen. Because it's part of the game, and everybody has gone through it. Everybody who's had great success in life, and, you know, from these stories that I just shared with you, it's pretty obvious that some of the greatest stories, they actually have some of the, you know, worst case scenarios happen to them. Yet, that, like I said in the beginning, that's what separates great people, successful people, from the rest of the crowd, because they are able to, it's not because they know something that nobody else does, it's because they're able to push through even when the difficulty time comes. They're able to restart and continue going and getting towards that success. I hope this video was helpful to you, and if you've liked it, please like it for me, and subscribe for more similar content in the future. I hope always to bring something new and something interesting in terms of self-development, and hopefully you can learn from it just the way I learn from it when I go through this material. So thank you for being with me, and I'll see you in the next video. Thanks.